We'll be right back. We're into the fourth day of the Uber Cup, one of the highlights of the badminton calendar. And while there have been a few surprises along the way, the groups are pretty much taking the shape expected. Japan overcame an early hiccup against Malaysia, while the host nation, India, really got things rocking with a wonderful display against Thailand. With Saina and Sindhu leading the way, they got the crowd on their feet. Desperation from the opposition with hopes of a first semi-final really becoming a possibility now. A very good afternoon, a warm welcome then to day four of the Leaning Thomas and Uber Cups. I'm Richard Kaufman, alongside former Denmark international Jim Laglesen. We're at the Siri Fort Sports Complex in the capital city of India, in the heart of Delhi, a venue that was refurbished in time for the Commonwealth Games that were staged here back in 2010. And this afternoon we're focusing on the Group Z clash. Yep, it's Japan against Denmark, both nations with two wins out of two against Germany and Malaysia. So this a group decider to see who will be seeded going into the quarterfinals. So after their 3-2 win over Malaysia, the Danes handed out a 5-0 drubbing to Germany yesterday. Although it's fair to say there was some German resistance with the final two women's singles clashes going the distance. Pedersen and Ewell only played 6 points, an injury to the opposition, saving some needed energy maybe for this afternoon's clash. Japan arrived as the group favourites, but they suffered a bit of a wobble early on yesterday against Malaysia, as Ti Ying-ji, the world number 50, overcame Sayaka Takahashi to give the Malaysians a surprise 1-0 lead. But the rest of the Japanese team held their nerve, and now the second most successful side in Uber Cup history will be looking to end the group stages on a high. And there was a puffing of cheeks and worry in the camp, but Erika Hirose there getting her job done against Lim. Time winners eventually coming through 4-1 yesterday against Malaysia. So confirmation of how it ended for the Japanese yesterday, a fright in that first women's singles, but after that they didn't drop a set. The Malaysians fought hard against them, but to no avail, 16-year-old world junior champion Akane Yamaguchi completing the victory for them. So those results mean it's Denmark and Japan definitely through to the quarterfinals. The only question now, in which order? Germany and Malaysia left to fight it out on court three for third place. Oh, bless you. Oh dear. Well, let's hope that's the only problem the Japanese have here this afternoon. And still the match going on one of the other courts from this morning's matches as well between Indonesia and Korea. I think they realized they're on camera. So let's have a look at how they line up this afternoon, shall we? Mitani back on as first singles for Japan. She'll be favourite against Lina Kiesfeldt. The match of the day, the first of the women's doubles clashes, the world numbers 3 and 4 meet. Sayaka Takahashi, she'll be looking to bounce back, won't she? And a first Uber Cup outing for the youngest ever Danish national champion, Mia Blichfeldt, in a clash of the 16-year-olds, isn't it, against Yamaguchi. So, Jim, heart and head time for you. How are Denmark going to perform here this afternoon?
Tough one. Of course, I have Japan as favourites, but I think that the Danish girls have been doing really well so far. They've been performing quite well. Of course, where it's going to be a big problem for the Danish team is in the ladies' singles. I see that's where Japan is really clear favourites, where in the ladies' doubles, then the Danes have bigger chances.
Well, Chi Ting Yi showed yesterday that you can upset the Japanese singles. Takahashi this time taking on Sandra Maria Jensen. And Jensen's up as number two because we're going to get a first look this week at Mia Blichfeldt.
Well, that's something the Danes have, of course, have been looking at. And of course, they can come in and say, well, it can be done. So, but everything has to be perfect for the Danes to win this one.
Yeah, so lots to look forward to this afternoon. In fact, it's the first of Japan-Denmark clash here, because they're also playing tonight in the Thomas Cup, and they met in the Sudermen Cup last year as well, so familiar foes.
Yeah.
The Germans, you can always tell where they are, can't you?
Good support.
I hope that's not going over his mouth.
No, I thought it was going to close his mouth.
And they've got their drums, they've got their rattles, and of course the hats with the bells on. I wouldn't like their excess baggage there.
No.
Bill, would you?
No. Yeah, still some Indonesian supporters left.
Yeah, they're obviously having a long battle, aren't they, against Korea.
It's been drawing all morning. There's one of the players, Sandra Mary Jensen.
She was very happy yesterday after her win, wasn't she? She was, I think, a little down after the first day defeat she had.
Yeah. She looks happy.
I mean, would it be fair to say for Denmark that getting to the quarterfinals was a minimum? Now this is a big match, really, in terms of maybe enhancing their chances of getting to the semis.
Definitely, yeah. The first goal for them was to, or target was to, get out of the group stages. Now it's, can they beat Japan? Then they can avoid, or will get a better seat for the drawing and avoid some really tough competition in the other group.
Well, Denmark are the European champions. There's Germany, who they beat. And Japan, well, the group favourites, aren't they? Well, we're having a little bit of a delay here. Not too sure the reason why we're not underway just yet, as we see the German huddle. Of course, they're in the other match that's going to be on court three. And Germany take on Malaysia. They're the two teams that have lost both their matches so far. But it was Malaysia in competition with Japan yesterday. And this was the opening group match. Ti Jing Yi, the world number 50 from Malaysia, taking on Soyaka Takahashi, the world number 13. And this probably one of the big upsets, if you like, individual matches-wise, of the Uber Cup so far.
Yeah, she played really well. She took her chances, was very aggressive, and gave Malaysia a really good start.
Yeah, I think throughout, even against Denmark, I think Malaysia performed really well. But for Ti Jing Yi herself personally, she's won two matches out of two now. A player who retired. Mm. She was, she hung up the racket for a month, and I think she's pretty pleased now she made the right decision. She won in Iran, and now this.
I think she is, and I think the Malaysian Badminton Federation is very glad that she came out of retirement.
Yeah, of course, with Lydia Chair suffering yet another injury. Ti Jing Yi, look at the delight on her face. Look how much it meant. A wonderful win for her. Obviously, big disappointment for Takahashi. She'll get the chance to make amends here this afternoon now. Hello. Let's hope their badminton's better than their dancing, eh? Look at that, they've got the glasses and everything. Definitely worth a picture, that one. Yeah. It's going to be tough. It's going to be actually an interesting match. You'd make Malaysia favourites, wouldn't you, to beat Germany in that one, given the way they've played so far?
Yeah, but don't underestimate Germany. They've been really, really close to upsetting in the first two matches. They've been so close. They've been up in the deciding sets. So, good team spirit. And here's the Danish team, the coach Jesper Larsen.
Yeah, so Lazu and the Danish team. There's the Japanese team there. getting ready for their pre-match huddle as well.
No dancing?
I don't think the Japanese are a little more reserved than the Germans, I think. But no doubt they'll be as keen to win their match here this afternoon as well. They are the group favourites, really. Japan yesterday coming through 4-1, as we said, against Malaysia. And while we're waiting for this match to start, great to see Akane Yamaguchi yesterday, of course, the World Junior Champion. She's only 16. She was a little slow out of the blocks against Lim here, but in the end, she managed to find her range. One thing Morden was saying perhaps about her game was maybe not enough aggression, and I think that's something labelled in general Japanese players, isn't it?
Particularly
the women.
It is. As we saw, especially when we talked a lot about in the hall here, there's a lot of drift, and it's difficult just to control the match and just rely on you can play it around. You got to take initiative. And that's not something that stands out in Japanese players. They don't, especially not the ladies' things, they don't take that much initiative.
This is Lim, who beat Sandra Maria Jensen on the first day. But Yamaguchi, obviously a very exciting talent. She won the Japan Open in her first ever Super Series event. She came through the qualifiers, 16 years of age, became the youngest ever winner of a Super Series event. So obviously great talent, but maybe just that extra dimension needed for a game.
Yeah.
But she came through.
But
he's
also staying at the top. You can see that's where you. That's the difficult part. It's not that easy to go in the Japanese Open, but you know, everybody will suddenly look at you in a different perspective. And
sure, they know about you now. You're not an unknown quantity. And she found it a little tough going early on, but she saw her class come through in the end with a straight games victory against Lim, who I thought performed really well, particularly on day one. But whereas Yamaguchi saw there, maybe struggled with the overheads, Lim really, whenever she had the opportunity, she took them. So that was the result that sealed the deal, if you like, a 4-1 victory for Japan yesterday against Malaysia. So just a reminder of who we'll be watching. So Mitani's back as first singles against Lina Kiersfeldt. Then it's the really big clash, isn't it? With two of the pairs ranked in the top five of the world, Jordan Peterson of Denmark, Matsutomo and Takahashi. That's Sayaka's sister, Ayaka, who's playing in that women's double. Then it's Sayaka herself looking for revenge, if you like, after her disappointment yesterday against Jensen. And then two pretty evenly balanced women's doubles pairs again in the second of them, with Kikawa and Maeda up against Krusa and Rupka. And then I think even if it's all done by the fifth women's singles, it's still going to be a terrific watch, I think. Mia Blichfeldt against Akane Yamaguchi.
It's the future. It's the future. Hopefully for Denmark, it's the future that Mia can go up and challenge these Asian players. But the first three matches, are vital, you know. For Denmark, if they have a chance.
Denmark are favourites, perhaps in match two.
Match two, yeah. Then let's say the score is 1-1 when we get to match three. Then we saw yesterday the Japanese girls. She was not at her A game, and of course Sandra Marie Jensen has seen that. And therefore, she can come in with a high spirit and maybe play a little bit freely. And
so there's the Danish team. Obviously, you've been in this situation, obviously in the Uber Cup, the Thomas Cup. Today's a kind of a relaxed day, isn't it, if you like? I know you. That Denmark,
not if your target is higher than just getting through the group, then you want to have that seat.
But you know you're through to the quarterfinals.
That's
it's
true.
Not you can lose today and you're not out.
No.
Tomorrow and beyond,
it's different ballgame.
There'll be a different. I mean, they look pretty relaxed. I mean, obviously.
I think it's the Danish way. It's pretty relaxed.
Yeah.
No, not. but no, yeah. It's of course. You can also say that they have reached their target. So that's of course for the coaches and Finn Treup Hansen, who's the sports manager there, is a good thing. Yeah, that's Finn Treup Hansen, and of course he's relaxed. You know, he's put a lot of effort into a ladies' single project in Denmark, which we're seeing there. Which we're seeing here.
Yeah, Morten was saying yesterday he was the one that basically was the selectors, upset a few people by picking youngsters like Jensen and
Yeah, but that was down in, when he was under 19 national coach. Yeah. He did that.
I picked them for the World Juniors, yeah.
And I overtook these girls. And after that, the national center made a group of girls coming up to try and help them go through after Tine Baum Rasmussen quit playing badminton. We're still looking for that one who's going to take over. We've always been privileged having a new one taking over after Camilla Martin. It was
sure.
Tine, and kind of same situation in the men's singles in Denmark, but they're just a little bit further.
Sure. Well, you've got number three in the world now,
yeah.
in Jana Jorgensen. So while we're waiting for some badminton to get underway here this afternoon, they'll be out pretty shortly. There's been an interesting clash out in Group X of the Uber Cup this morning when Korea took on Indonesia. And obviously both these nations favoured to do pretty well this week. This was Linda Wenny-Fenetri up against Sung Ji-hyun. And, well, they're all called a while, 48 minutes, but it was a straight games win for Sung. And I think Korea overall showing that once again, Jim, they are maybe one of the teams that could upset China in the latter stages of the Uber Cup this week, coming through in the end 4-1 in the overall scoreline.
Yeah, they have a strong team.
But it was a good match. Fenetri, like Simon Santoso, really a player who went out of the national squad and has come back maybe better than when she was, you know, being funded by the Indonesian team.
Yeah, well, you can say it is a big thing to be in the Indonesian squad, and then they've had to fight their way back into it. Maybe it's good to get a fresh start sometimes.
Yeah, Ferdasari won in the final singles match against Kim Hyo-min, and that only just finished. I mean, they were on court for 5 to 6 hours. I don't know why maybe that's one of the reasons behind a delay here, or maybe there's some traffic in Delhi that's held up the coaches from the hotel here, but we are being held up. We really should have been underway by now. And
I think it was. I don't think you can put on the other matches before the first session matches is finished. Maybe that's it. I don't know.
Okay, we are hearing confirmation. It was that because of court two overran. I didn't realize that would affect court one as well, but it has. So we're a couple of minutes away from play starting. We're estimating it will start about 20 past 2 o'clock local time, which is, as I say, only a few minutes away now. So there was Sung getting her joy against Fenetri. And, well, she stuck with it, Fenetri, but 21-12, 21-18 looks a very comfortable scoreline, doesn't it? But when you know they were on court for close to 50 minutes, you know it was a bit of a slog. There's two matches there of over an hour and 18 minutes for the first women's doubles match and an hour and 8 minutes for the second women's doubles match. So I wonder whether we'll get more of that this afternoon.
Yeah. Well, I would, you know, the way that Christina and Camilla is playing, they're very aggressive in the service situation. They're more like a men's doubles way in playing that. I don't think we should think that that will go to that distance. But you see it sometimes.
We've seen the Indian men there. They're in action this afternoon against Germany. They had a disappointing time of it, really, compared to the women who really have been brilliant and have won their group now.
Yeah.
This is the way it's finished in Group X of Korea. I suppose, as expected, the group winners with Indonesia second. Singapore claiming third spot with their win over Australia this morning. But I don't think any surprise to see that Group X finish like that, really. So Korea will be seeded. India, we know, will be seeded. Would it be Denmark or Japan as well? China, one would expect as well.
Yeah.
Well, we see that. I don't think they dropped a game yet, never mind a match.
And you want to avoid them if you are to have a chance of any.
Well, the men have dropped a couple of games. Lin Dan last night dropped one. Men's doubles pair have dropped a game as well. Yeah, Lin Dan was a game down against Lin of another Lin last night.
Maybe they got confused.
He was 11-10 down in the second game as well. Officials are on their way out. We're going to have some badminton very shortly. Well, it's going to be a long day for them, with Japan, Denmark on court next as well after this one. No, not a repeat, but the Thomas Cup version. And it's good to see there's quite a few crowd coming into the stadium now. And it hasn't been that busy, has it, over the first 3 days? But it's a little busier today than one would expect. Once the knockout stages come along, it will fill up. Around 3,000 you can get inside the Siri Fort Sports Complex. We really are in the heart of Delhi. On our way from the hotel, we get past a lot of sights and get a real feel of the ambience of the capital city of India, second most populous country in the world. So this is our first match. It's a women's singles clash between Minatsu Mitani and Lina Kiesfeld. And here they come, Japan, better late than never. Represented by Minatsu Mitani, and Denmark, represented by Lin Kiesfeld. So Mitani, the world number 12, up against Lina Kiesfeld here, who's just inside the top 50. Not been in great form, Mitani, though. She played in the first match against Germany and then was left out against Malaysia. I don't know if that was a tactical thing or trying to give everyone an opportunity, but she was the only one against Germany who dropped a set. So you just wonder whether that was a little bit of a ruthless decision or just something that was planned.
I think it was a tactical decision to give her a break before this match. It could be in the other thing, but then...
Well, Lina Kiesfeld, red, the number one, as she was at last year's Sudermen Cup post, as you were saying, Tina Baum Rasmussen. She didn't win any single matches at last year's Sudermen Cup, but she started with a loss to Ti Jing Yi, but yesterday got the better of Kara Schnaz, a very tight opening game, 23-21, 21-18 in the second. So both these players had their struggles against Schnazer. So maybe it might be a little more evenly matched than the rankings suggest. Stadium's rocking now, isn't it? Let's have a look at some of the statistics then of Mitani. 22 years of age, ranked 12. And as you can see, not her best season so far. Made the quarterfinals in January at the Malaysian Open, yet to get beyond the second round after that. She lost in the first round of the Asian Badminton Championships to a player ranked 110 spots below her in Li Jiangmi. So encouragement there, really, you would say, for her opponent this afternoon, who is, as we've said, Denmark's Lina Kiesfeld. Denmark's currently number one. Had an excellent week in Basel at the European Championships. Led from the front in that, winning her singles all week long. 20 years of age, so very much a youngster still. And as you can see, a far more positive season for her in terms of winning. Runner-up at the Swedish Masters in January. Quarter-finalist at the European Championships, winning the Finnish International April, but she's playing a different level of tournament.
Much lower level tournaments than Mitani, so we can't really read too much into that. But of course, it's good, a good way to, you know, develop a player, to get some wins under the belt, to get the confidence. So maybe Japan needs to look at that with Mitani.
Here's our officials for our opening match. It's Gerald Arsenal of Canada, who is our umpire, and Unang Sukaja of Indonesia is the service judge for
this
one.
Can you bring the thing inside the bucket, please? and your accreditation.
So it looks like we're not far away now from getting underway. Denmark against Japan.
Can you put
group winners to be decided. Coaches take their seats.
Yes.
And this is where the nerves jangle most, I would have thought, Jim, knowing that just about to get going.
Yeah, this is it.
Well, can Lina Kiyasova upset Japan?
Ladies and gentlemen,
singles player.
On my right, Denmark, represented by Lina Kiyasova. On my left, Japan, represented by Mitani Minotu. Japan to serve. Love all. Play.
So the European champions up against the group favourites, Denmark, Japan. Quarterfinalists guaranteed, but who will be seeded? First point goes the way of Denmark.
One love. Sorry.
Given long, it wasn't out by much though, was it?
It was over 1-0.
Probably too early in the match to start chasing for Hawkeye, but
yeah, could come in better use later.
2-1.
Yeah, see, Lina is a very aggressive player. She's actually equally really, really good in ladies doubles and really, really good in mixed doubles as well. So she had the choice when she was under 19. She had to kind of pick what she really wanted to play, and so far has been going the right way in her ladies singles.
She still does play a little bit of doubles, doesn't she?
She does in the team, and I had her last year under 19 where at the European Championship, and I actually used her in mixed double in the team event, and she was just way better than most of the others. So you can see she's living out her dream in the singles, and then hopefully it goes all the way. And if not, she has the ability to go in and play one of the other wins. Disciplines. I don't think it's an disciplines.
Yeah.
Get my point.
Absolutely, yeah. I think events is fine as well. Yeah, she's going for a shot, isn't she, Lina? Obviously, given the scoreline, they haven't all come off, but she's trying to. There's another example.
Yeah, and that's her weakness in her game, is that she's not really good at the game where you control and you have patience building up your shot. She goes too quickly for it. And that's not good when you're up against Mitani, because she likes that. She's just going to keep that shuttle over and over and over again. So she needs to have a little bit of patience, but you can see even her patience shot, that's not a shot she's used to or want to go to. So therefore we have an easy mistake. She's more an attacking player.
Played by Mitani. Just long.
Service over. 3-6.
Oh, nice shot. Nice disguise shot.
Service over. 7-3.
talking about the women's doubles, you with Jensen, who's on next, didn't they play together, didn't they, in the World Juniors?
And yeah.
Picked up a bronze medal. Singles is kind of, I know you play doubles, but it kind of seen as the glamour, isn't it?
It is, which is, coming from a doubles player's perspective, a little bit annoying.
Yeah.
But that's just how it is. But at least it's closer to singles, can you say, knowledge-wise, acknowledge-wise, than men's doubles in tennis,
sure,
for example.
Sure, yeah.
So, which I also think is a shame.
But there are double specialists in tennis as well.
9-4.
Well, it's been a very solid start, hasn't it, from Minatsu Mitani here from Japan.
Oh, nice shot by Nina.
Service over. 5-9.
Not a very effective smash from Mitani.
Serve is long.
Service over.
Pity,
10,
that was a nice rally
5.
She had before then. Thought that just might settle her down.
Oh, lucky.
11-5.
Yep, slice
interval.
Of luck for Mitani. And it takes her into a pretty large interval lead. Yeah, one of those that could have gone either way. The apology, but the point. So Minatsu Mitani looking very comfortable so far. Kiersfeld not really settled in. Here's the Japanese who has an 11-5 lead. I suppose the message is, as you were suggesting, maybe a little patience from Lazu to Lina there.
Coach, thank you.
Yeah, but the problem is, I've got...
Strap, Mitami.
And the problem is, it doesn't suit her game. So it's difficult
11,
for her, but she has
5.
To do it. She has to try and play a little bit more patient. If she keeps on playing that way she started here, but I don't think she will be able to win this.
Service over. 6.
Yeah, because given the way it's happened so far in the women's singles for Japan as well, with Mitani dropping a set against Schnars and then Ji Ying T beating Takahashi, she, you know, there could be, you know, she could put some pressure on if she could fight back in against Mitani. There may be a way psychologically to affect your opponent.
Yeah.
7-11.
She speed up her game a little bit more now. You can see she's.
And also look at the reaction here from Mitani. You know, she's still, you know, look how frustrated she is with it. But she's 11-7 up. Imagine, you know, she starts trading. What's her reaction going to be like then?
Yeah.
Given out.
8-11.
Much better by Lina. Come out of a different tempo.
Service over. 12-8.
Oh, good shot.
Service over. 9-12. 12.
Done it again.
Yeah, it's a common thing that Lina, I think, has sometimes a little bit of trouble seeing those disguise shots, especially to the front court, because she's looking so much to jump into those overplays that her opponent is. And there you see again the front court. She doesn't like that.
14-9.
Yeah, it's been very well played by Mitani. It's brought her a lot of rewards as well.
Again, too little patience. 15, too early to go for winners. So you can see that's kind of her game. You see her do three really good shots and then she loses three. You know, it's too much up and down.
Mitani just hasn't really been stressed throughout this game so far, has she really?
No, not at all. And she's controlling it.
16,
and Lina
9.
Needs to balance it more in her game while still keeping the pace up. And that is the most difficult thing in badminton, is to have the right pace where you don't do mistakes. If you are too pacey, you have a tendency to go too early for stuff and then you make easy mistakes. So. Like that, for example. That was
service
good.
Over. 10-16.
Thank you, Mitani. And especially in a hole like this with the drift, it's almost impossible. You have to be very, very, very good balance to try these things.
11-16.
Point like an insult to Mitani at the moment.
She's not the hardest hitter, so I think she has to be very careful of smashing too hard, especially to Lina, because she will counter it straight off. She was way more successful when she gets in her drop shots like that. So I think she needs to stay to a very simple game. That's
well played.
But that was 13, better by Mitani. See, she has Lina under more pressure when she does that.
Well, 16-9 down now. 16-13 here.
Late.
You're suggesting is there may be a a downward trend in the moment for Chiesa. Yeah.
That's what she has to be careful of.
14-16.
And that's what I, you know, we talked about yesterday. And that's, if there was a thing I would like to see better in Japanese lady singles play, it's their ability to take the initiative. You know, every time they try to attack, I don't think it's that well organized. And it's, there's no variation.
Important point, this.
Very.
And Nina's taking it again. Well, what a good comeback this is proving to be. 6 points in a row 16. Now, just 1 point between them. And now she is under pressure, Mitani.
Of course, we have to remember she's standing on the side where she can't really She can't really pushes Clears too much, because then the drift is going to drag it out on the backcourt. So that has a lot to say. That's a good shot.
That's so frustrating, isn't it?
Yeah.
17, she says she played 15. A good shot. I'm not sure if she was half expecting it not to come back to her.
Yeah. It's important for Lina now to stay in the match.
I think she got caught in two minds there, didn't she?
Yeah. But again, it comes to where she gets, you know, and that's what Mitani can do against Lina. She can basically say, okay, I'm just going to rally until Lina runs out of options. And she did that. Over 16-18. Yeah, there we have it again, the drop shot. It's a much better solution for Mitani. Well played. You can see Lina is having trouble. First of all, she can't see the disguise in it. Second of all, she doesn't like to be played on the front court. Yeah, that's good.
Well, sticking in.
Service over. 17-19.
I think Mitani, I thought maybe that was going out. It could have been, but she played it and netted it.
But you see, Lina now is, I think Lars has told her to push it to the backcourt and then just go forward. You know, Mitani's not going to play the backcourt. So what she can do from there is to keep Mitani on the backcourt, and it's very difficult for her to get out of, because she can't hit it hard to the backcourt on the other side, because then it's going to go out.
Well, 19-0.
19.
And from a seemingly position of real authority, Mitani here has been caught for the first time since she went in the lead very, very early on in this match. Body blow for Kiesveld.
Service over.
Lina should probably have kept it 19. To the round ahead side. Still playing too short across. But good shot by, a good decision by Mitani to go for the body.
So game point for Benatsu Mitani. Oh, wonderful play.
Great shot.
Well, she was tested. She was put under pressure, and she came through it.
First game won Minatsu by Mitani. Japan, 21.
Really 19. Delightful winning shot from her here as well. Found the angle. Nothing at all Nina Kiesveld could do about that. She fought hard to get herself back in this opening game, but to no avail, because it's Minatsu Mitani who has emerged out on top. Really good opening game though, 21 points to 19. Given a bit of a fright there, Minatsu, but she played very well on the 2 points when she was caught at 19-0, didn't she? Positives really for both coaches to speak of as well. Kersfeld certainly looked stronger, didn't she, after the
court
interval.
Court 1, 20 seconds. Court 1, 20 seconds. Coach.
So the opening game going coach. The way of Minatsu Mitani of Japan up against Denmark's Lina Kersfeld. This is the first of the women's singles, a 5-rubber match. All five played. This is the last day in which that will happen from the quarterfinals. It's the first to win three who wins overall.
Second game. Love all. Play.
Yeah, and of course Lina's going to have the same problems that Mitani had in the first set. She's going to have difficulty finding the back line. On the other hand, it's going to suit Mitani really, really well now because she can push her clears big time to the backcourt, and that's going to leave problems for Lina. So she's going to have to attack a lot. It's going to be really hard. We see already there. Oh, well played. Using the backcourt and then waiting for that short clear to come and then attack.
Found the gap really well. And then Kersfeld's got to be careful here. She let Mitani get away in that first game. She doesn't want to do it again here. A point on the board for the Dane.
Service over. 1-2.
That's one of the men's singles players. Especially Wiesing, who's sitting there.
So he'll be in action later.
Service over. 3-1.
Anna Madsen down there watching. She's not required today. 2 wins out of 2 so far from her.
Yeah, and it's quite surprising, you can say. She's won both her matches. Madsen, who's been having a good run
Five,
here, who surprisingly went to the final of the European Championship. So after 3 to 5 girls that was there, wasn't expected, it was her. Oh, good clear from Lina. And that's important. It's very important for her that she believes that she can hit that clear. Even with the drift, should be giving her some confidence then. that if she needs it, she can hit it.
Service over, 6-3.
From
7-3. There.
She's staying solid, isn't she? I just wondered whether she might crack, put under pressure, but no, she stayed rock solid, didn't she? Really, two good points at the end of the last game to clinch it, and now she's won 7 of the first 10 in this second.
Service over. 4-7.
She was the first Japanese player to win a Super Series title in Aunt Sumitani when she beat the likes of Tina Baum and Sina Nawa when she won the French Open in 2012.
5-7.
They went to
seven.
Her in 2013, and as we mentioned already, been a bit of a struggle for her this year.
Service over. 8-5.
Delightful. Really nice from Mitani. Nearly. Right idea.
So
she's pulled it off enough times, isn't
six,
she? Not that time.
10. Service over. 11-6 interval.
So 11-6 to Mitani at the interval. Well, it looks as if Mitani is going to get her team off
court
to
120 seconds. Court
the
one
perfect start
20
here.
Seconds. Coach. Denmark, coach, thank you.
So it's a comfortable interval lead, as it was in the first game for Minatsu Mitani.
11-6, play.
Now, come on, behave yourselves. More frustration for Kirsfeld there.
6.
Oh, good shot. But I think we're seeing the signs of what could have.
Service over.
What I talked about, that
seven.
Mitani is feeling more comfortable on that side where she's standing now. It suits her game more. And it actually the kind of game that Lina's supposed to play, where she has to play a little bit, a lot of patience, is not really her favorite. So she's being forced to the back, as we see there, and then whoa.
That was very unlike Mitani, wasn't it?
Yeah, and that's what Lina has to hope for. Well, stick in there, keep it close, as close as possible, and then hope for that she can come up when it's really needed. That's the challenge. Yeah, that is a challenge.
Challenge.
Well, I'm not going to call that one.
Gersfeld said it was out. I have a feeling a certain man next to me called Jim Laugson said it was out.
Yeah, I would say it was out.
Given in.
What? Already? No. I think it's out as well. But
challenge,
she wasn't that sure.
It's
one
in.
Remaining.
It was a tiny bit of it that was out, but only a tiny
service
bit.
Service over. Yeah. 13.
But I've actually found out you can actually see it on the reaction of the players. If the hand comes up straight away, then normally,
yeah,
that's a good reason for it. But if it comes late, it's more, you know, challenge, hope.
It's a lovely network.
Yeah, Mitani's controlling the match now.
14-8.
Lina's constantly a step behind. She needs to see if she can take the net a little bit more, I think. Be more aggressive. If Mitani's allowed to. Ooh, that's a white serve. If Mitani's allowed to control it like we saw on the rally before, it's going to be a long, long day for Lina. So.
14. Service over. 15-9.
Game to the pick away now, isn't it, for Denmark in this opening women's singles. Her lead here is big as the one, if not bigger now, actually, than the one she had in that opening game, Mitani. She did get things closed down by Kiersfeld there, but.
But you saw some, you saw she had more options then. That's what she has now.
Nine.
Look at those clears.
Yeah.
You can just power them. You can hear it. It's almost like a smash, you know, and it's
18,
so
nine.
Difficult to handle for Lina.
Yeah, one corner of the court to the other corner, and then in with the follow-up, and suddenly she's 3 points away for victory.
Yeah. is very rare. Well, Mitani.
Disappointment for Kiesfeldt. But Mitani is growing in confidence here. Now just 2 points away from claiming an opening victory. Really is good badminton for Mitani, isn't it?
Yeah, she's playing really well.
Match points, lots and lots
match
of them.
Point nine.
And that's it.
Game.
35 minutes is all it took in the end. Tied opening game. Nice comeback from Kiesfeldt in that, but there was no fight back for her in game number two as Mitani grew in confidence and started playing some really top-class badminton.
Match won by Japan, 21-19, 21-9.
Excellent performance from Mitani. So the world number 12 gets the job done. Kiesfeldt just kind of ran out of ideas, didn't she? Patience took the better of her in terms of the winning point. So a winning start for Japan in this decider for the group. 21-19, 21-9, the winning scoreline for Minatsu Mitani. Signs maybe in this opening game that Kiesfeldt might be able to find a way of upsetting her higher ranked opponent, but the more this match went on, as I was saying, Minatsu Mitani grew in confidence. She got less and less frustrated with things and hardly put a foot wrong.
Yeah, and the second set too was, you could see she got comfortable. Just rolled a little lean.
One-sided affair in the end in the second game. That was the moment where moments where Kiesfeldt was fighting back, but in this second game, when it was pretty much one-way traffic, 21-9 in the end, the scoreline. And now we've got really is on paper a high-caliber women's doubles match to look forward to. Japan were always favourite and really in all the women's singles matches here. Much tied in the women's doubles, but I have to say now with Japan winning that opening singles match, well, is there a way back for Denmark? They have to win the next. So Japan off to a flying start, thanks to Minatsu Mitani. It's obviously now Japan 1, Denmark 0, but can Denmark lever up? It's women's doubles time, and what should be a very good match between the number 4 ranked players from the world of badminton in the women's doubles against the number 3. It's Misaki Matsutomo and Ayaki Takahashi against Camilla Rutuyo and Christina Pedersen. Familiar foes. They've played each other 6 times over the last 4 years. Familiarity sometimes breeds contempt, but interesting point, really, and I know it's been spoken about a few times over the week, that the court conditions here should favour the Danes.
Yeah, it's what they like, and we've also seen some of the tournaments where they've been doing well, and it's been in these conditions, you know, where it's difficult to control the shuttle because of the drift, and it makes of course the court is not getting smaller visually, but it makes the court smaller. That means you're not going all the way to the line, you're playing a little bit too short, the service game gets really important, and the Danish girls are just very, very strong at that. They're, first of all, they are very strong, second of all, they're very tall compared to their opponents here, and